This is Nathan Sanderson. I'm the Public Information Officer for the Southeast Area Incident Management Team. To begin our press conference this morning, I'd like to introduce Lieutenant Governor of the State of South Dakota, Matt Michaels.
Thank you, Nathan, and good morning. From Dakota Valley in the southeastern reach of the flood fight in South Dakota. I'd like to give you a picture of what our day has been like already in this state. And I want to take you from this morning. The governor got up very early, as did I. And the governor walked down here in Dakota Dunes, walked a primary area around the levee, walked through the areas that really need to be reinforced and fortified for this oncoming flood. Looked at that for a while and then came up and we had a meeting with the operational people at 7 this morning that are all out serving the southeastern area. A 70-mile fight. And to give you a perspective, a lot of times we specifically say the Dakota Dunes, but it is not accurate to say that that is solely the direction and activity that's going on. And so the briefings and actions that take place are for the 70-mile reach down here, commencing at Gavin's Point in Yankton, and all of the way down here to the end of the river reach in South Dakota. After that meeting with those individuals, they're deployed out to their various assignments that we'll talk about in a minute. The governor and I have a meeting with all of the individuals involved in the contracting, the coordination, evacuation of these various areas. And that just completed about an hour and a half ago, and the governor is not here and asked for me to speak in his stead for him and the people of South Dakota because his and Linda's son, Chris, is being married today in Sioux City. And I asked for him, and we said, both of us and our families, we all have one son. And I said, for all of us that are going through things, he wanted me, and I want to express to everyone that just reinforces that we are certainly all going through stress. We all certainly have our anchors, our homes, our belongings, our lives uprooted. But that in the end, that this is about people that love us, people we take care of, communities, and marrying off your son and inviting a new young lady into your family and expanding your family. And all of these efforts have been about South Dakota and a greater family. Every place that we go, we see a lot of love, we see a lot of work, a lot of hope, true South Dakota spirit. I want to also thank the media throughout the reach, throughout all of South Dakota and the region, for covering these facts and information and providing access. The worst thing that we can have is misinformation, and there certainly has been a lot of that, and our media friends and the coordination of that help us out to give accurate information so that people can react appropriately. In Pierre, I'd like to, they will dive into that more deeper, but in Pierre, we are obviously putting the tops on the levees, watching the river rise, and waiting as the increases of the flows are coming down. I'll let the individuals from the Corps and other people, the mayors from there, talk specifically what's transpiring. But to personalize this, about a week and a half ago, whenever this started, my wife and I have an apartment up there, and she was sandbagging while we were in the Emergency Operations Center. And all of our friends are involved in protecting our properties. And so in the Pierre, Fort Pierre region, everyone is watching the water releases rise and watching the levees as they're finished. Volunteers, the National Guard, and residents have filled and placed over 3.5 million sandbags in this southeastern area. And 4 million more have been ordered. There are currently in this operational area 4 helicopters. There are 3 Blackhawks and recently arrived yesterday as one Vertol CH, we call them Chinooks 47s.
A 47, a Chinook, a dual prop. And so you'll look at that, a very large helicopter, and they're flying 30 sorties a day, moving over 200,000 pounds of material to help construct the levees. There are approximately 800 large helibags, 1 ton each, on the ground waiting for placement. We actually just inspected that area as we came up. The crews are delivering over 350 of these monstrous helibags a day. In addition to that, we have security forces in place for Yankton, Windstone, Riverland, Dakota Dunes, and several other areas to secure these regions. I want to walk you down in the southeastern area what's transpiring. As you go to the face of the dam in Gavin's Point in Yankton, and in that region, there was over 47,000 sandbags filled yesterday by inmates, National Guards, and volunteers. There's over 175 volunteers arriving yesterday, more pouring in, and there are over 58 firefighters from the Yankton and Lesterville area. Just for a point of interest, I grew up in Vermilion, and our home for the last 22 years is in Yankton. South Dakota is our home. Have only left for the period of time when I was in the military. And so I know this reach, I know these people, and know our friends and neighbors all the way down here. And it is impressive. It's impressive how people are coming together in that region, just like every place else affected with this flood fight. As we move down through Clay County, there are assessments that are being taken place on infrastructure, water, providing sandbagging assistance there as well in areas down below in Vermilion and other areas. As we come down to the more populated areas around the river down in this region, we come to an area called Windstone and North Sioux City, where we're meeting right now in Dakota Valley. If you're not familiar with this geography, we're actually in North Sioux City, McCook Lake region. There's a reason that they call it McCook Lake, and we're going to talk about that in a minute. But the area of Windstone and North Sioux City have signed a mutual aid agreement to assist in the flood preparation. This is Union County. And a helicopter will be working in the area today, bringing in these large one-ton bags through with the Chinook for the community members to use. And that operation is going to take place all day. National Guardsmen have already helped sandbag around our water treatment plant, and approximately 100 guardsmen are going to be in the area here of Windstone all day assisting the community. That community association has developed a plan to construct a levee as well around the community, and the Southeast Incident Management Team, the group that the governor deployed here, is providing assistance all day, and we're briefed and people are working their tails off. I want to ask a request of individuals who are interested in seeing these areas. There's an area down in Yankton a couple of nights ago, they're all blurring, that I came into, and there was a huge sign that says, "Do not come in unless you want to work." And I will say that again in the Windstone area. Unless you're helping, unless it's your home, please stay out of there. Curiosity does not lift a sandbag. Driving through this area is a choke point. It creates security hazard. And I need to repeat this. The water is rising, and additional people looking around, not working and helping, is an impediment. You're clogging the system. So please stay off the road unless you're in there to help or you're moving or evacuating. In the McCook, North Sioux City area, we had the opportunity, the governor and I, yesterday with Mayor Don Fuchsa, as we walked through a Suncoast region here. Community had come together and developed a plan along McCook Lake. McCook Lake is actually part of the original river in an oxbow. It is pretty easy to understand this area when you look at maps, but people living on it, the Missouri River is going to try to reclaim its oxbow. And those individuals are sandbagging, working very hard, shooting their elevations. And what we're in the process of doing all throughout this region of 70 miles, and it is getting maps that show the elevation of what the river will be at the 150 cubic feet per second along with where your home is, and be able to give a map to say, this is what we believe with all the best information the water level will be at your home, so that you can make preparations. In some communities, they've already taken that initiative. In others, there's Department of Transportation surveyors out. In others, on the northern reach in Yankton and southern Yankton, there have been boaters out there putting markers to help community members. So the ingenuity needs to be cataloged, because it is impressive. I also would like to reiterate what the governor said yesterday, and that is, no boats are on McCook Lake. And their enforcement will be strong, because obviously boats create wake. And for that matter, if anybody is thinking about being on the Missouri River in a boat, you should have your heads examined. This is a dangerous river. If you think you understand this river, and as I've been saying in the past, I don't care if you are the greatest river rat throughout this stretch, it is a different beast. And they're cranking it up. And I know I'm sounding like I'm lecturing, and the governor has said this a number of times, but we have been down there. There is a lot of debris all the way down that are missiles. When this thing opens up, you can be hurt, you can be maimed, and we can replace property, but we can't replace mothers and fathers and children. So please stay off the river. Not only does it help you and the lake, too, at McCook Lake, it helps you, it helps everybody else. Let's talk about Dakota Dunes. The evacuation took place yesterday in an area south in the Pinehurst line. We called it the Country Club area, all the way south. And the cooperation in the evacuation was amazing. I'd like to speak to the people of Union County that you have no idea, like other counties, there are impressive public servants that we can talk about when these events have happened, and we will for years. But I want to specifically thank Sheriff Limoge and his deputies, because this is their home too. And they are taking time away to keep people safe, time away from their own families and their own issues, so that people can be evacuated, so that we can ensure that people are taken care of, and that a system, a respectful system, is put in place dealing with this tragedy in the evacuation of these various areas. It was like clockwork yesterday, and the people within the Country Club area of Dakota Dunes, we congratulate you. The governor and I are incredibly impressed how responsive you've been. It can only improve our levee process in the construction there. And a great kudo to all of our law enforcement that have been there, along with the security forces of the National Guard and Air Guard. The primary levee for us who are down here is nearing completion, in the sense that it is on track. I've seen it. We're going to go down again and see how we're doing. They've worked through the night, it is moving. It is anticipated that they'll be able to cap that off down here by midnight on Sunday. They are in the process of preparing then for the secondary levee, and the Corps is coordinating that with the general contractor as we speak. These contractors down in the levee construction area are currently operating 140 trucks hauling 25,000 yards of material per day, and they're using more than 50 pieces of heavy equipment to construct the levees. This, of course, does not include the orchestrated borrow pit operation that is able to give us all of the material that we need down there. Once these levees are completed, just like in Pier and Fort Pier, there will be 24/7 monitoring of structural integrity. And down here in the Dakota Dunes, there is a dewatering plan in place with over 16 pumps operating to dewater the area behind the primary levees. I'd like the public to know that here in the southeast reach, down in the Dakota Dunes, Union County, McCook Lake areas, the American Red Cross is operating a shelter at Dakota Valley Schools. That's at 1150 North Shore Drive, North Sioux City, South Dakota. There are currently no residents here at this time, but we're grateful for that capacity. The American Red Cross and the Salvation Army have been doing a tremendous job. Again, thank you for taking care of yourselves. And thank you for all the volunteers and the dedicated individuals who are involved. And I appreciate everything that you're doing for us, the people from out of state and all of our friends. South Dakotans are indeed a very, very resilient people, and we'll get through this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. Next, we'll go to the Emergency Operations Center in Pierre.
We'll start here with a report from the Corps of Engineers. To give that report is Eric Stash. His last name is spelled S-T-A-S-C-H. Eric.
Good morning. I'm going to start out with an update for the release schedule from the Oahe Dam. I want to emphasize the release schedule hasn't changed. It's still the releases that we're doing on a daily amount that we have been reporting for quite some time. As you know, yesterday we switched to a split that increase into two equal parts. We did that yesterday. We're doing that today. So at 8 o'clock, we bumped up 10,000 CFS. At 4 o'clock, we're going to bump up another 10,000 CFS. Now, according to the schedule that I've just received this morning from Omaha, they're going to look at the rest of the releases at 8 o'clock in the morning at 10,000 CFS a day. So Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday, 8 o'clock in the morning, 10,000 CFS a day. Come back to releases. Just to give everyone an idea of what happened with our increase of 15,000 CFS yesterday. We increased that 15,000 CFS over the day, and between 8 o'clock yesterday morning when we took our first release to when I read the gauge at 6 o'clock this morning, we had a 10.5-inch increase in water surface elevation. So for that 15,000 cubic foot increase in discharge, we increased the water surface downstream of the dam 10.5 inches. So that's, people can bank on that. That's right off the gauge. Very brief construction update here in Pier. The final plastic is going to be going on Pier today. I would be surprised if it isn't nearing completion right now. Fort Pier, the contractor continues to progress towards completion. We think all of the levees are topped out, and the main thing left is plastic in Fort Pier, and they're aggressively hitting that. So we're doing good. A brief update for downstream. I've got some information from down there just to pass along. The current release schedule for Gavin's Point is 100,000 CFS today, 110 tomorrow, on the 6th, 120, 7th, 130, on the 8th and the 9th, it's going to be 140. So 2 days, we're going to be at 140. On the 10th, 145, and we'll be at the 150,000 cubic feet per second on the 14th. It seems there's still a lot of questions coming in about the reservoir elevation above Gavin's Point. Gavin's Point elevation, the reservoir fluctuates about a foot. There's very minor fluctuation on that reservoir. So just that's not a huge concern right now, I think. But if you're in that near that area that's a little bit higher than normal, you should just realize that it's only going to fluctuate about a foot. As for the levees down at Dakota Dunes, and the Lieutenant Governor just talked about this a little bit, my update is the contractor in the sandbagging operations is getting into a rhythm, and they're getting their efficiencies going, so he's increasing production on that. The big thing is additional survey data has led to an engineering change on that secondary levee. Current elevation data shows that the long stretches along that levee alignment are lower than first anticipated. In order to achieve the top elevation needed, they can no longer use HESCO bastions to fill the to make that flood wall. So now we are going to earthen levees. That change order is already down in Omaha and is being processed at the Omaha level right now. If the contracting officer hasn't already signed that change order, it will be very shortly for the contractor to be able to proceed with that work. Briefly, I think that's about it for me.
Thank you, Ray. From here, we'll hear from local community representatives of the communities most affected. We'll start up here in Pier with Pier Mayor Lori Gill.
All right, from Pier. Currently, securing our public infrastructure and public safety remains key. That is our focal point. We've heard a report on the levees. We're feeling good about where the levees are at this point in Pier. The city continues to look around and identify any other unsecured areas. We're putting any protection that we need in place at this time as appropriate. In terms of our utilities, our drinking water system in Pier is secure. We get our water from a drinking well series, and we've secured the wells. We have adequate water supply, and the system is secure. Our wastewater treatment plant is secure. It's tied into one of the levees. So we have sandbagging operations completed there. We feel that that system is secure. Right now, we continue to work on our storm sewer system. We have plugged all of our storm drains at this time. We do that to prevent backflow in all possible scenarios. We're asking that if residents see water coming from storm drains in the community to please let City Hall know. We can get out and check that out, make sure everything's secure. We're also asking for residents to please limit water use that gets into the storm drainage system. That adds an extra pressure on our system that we don't need at this time. So everybody in the community can help us out with that one. Sandbagging operations continue today. We hope that by the end of the day, we'll have approximately 50,000 sandbags in Pier stockpiled for any use. The demand from the public at this point has dropped off, and we will be analyzing the sandbagging operations, making changes that are appropriate, but yet keeping operations at some level open in the community over the next few days. Dike security plan is complete and underway. And in terms of any emergency responses that are needed throughout the next days of rising water, our emergency response plan for any levee repairs is being developed. Materials, equipment, and locations are being prepared, and city staff and crews will receive training on emergency levee repairs so that we can respond to anything that we see that needs to be fixed. In terms of the voluntary evacuation areas, these are all of the affected areas that we have notified individuals. The majority of the folks that are living in the affected areas have evacuated at this time. We are ensuring that we will be able to patrol those areas and keep the areas safe, and credentialing for public access to flooded areas will begin at 8 a.m. Sunday morning at Georgia Morse Middle School. The credentials will allow security and residents to assure that no unauthorized people are in the flooded areas. So we'll be hearing more throughout the day regarding the credentialing process. And lastly, the Red Cross shelter remains open at Georgia Morse Middle School. For anybody that needs emergency shelter, that remains open and available to folks. And that concludes the Pier report.
Thank you, Mayor. Next, we'll hear from Fort Pier Mayor Sam Tidball.
Yes, evacuation is in the affected areas is pretty well completed in Fort Pier with 90%+ we estimate out. There are a few that are waiting, watching the water and ready to move. The levees are, for most part, as Mr. Stosch has indicated, are completed for most part. Work continues on some of the area north of the railroad and in the Dunes Drive area to harden those areas. We continue to work on storm sewer inflows, and pumping is ongoing. We've organized a pump crew to monitor and service those pumping stations or pumping operations. One thing I want everybody to take note is don't take actions from someone who is spreading rumors. If you hear some dire prediction, please check with authorities to find out whether they're substantial or not. We've heard about rumor going about that one of the big dams up above it broke and we're going to all be inundated. And so don't take that kind of a thing lightly. If you hear something like that, check, but don't take action until you do check, because rumors can be very damaging to what's going on. And so we ask everyone to be alert and report what may appear to be a problem or concern. Please also be safe. Don't take unnecessary risks. The National Guard and local law enforcement is monitoring the levees, streets, and buildings to provide protection for property. This is a serious time, but it's very important to keep a positive attitude. Some residents have added a little humor with signs, and I saw one sunbathing mannequin this morning on the top of the sandbags. And so if you can maintain a good attitude and good humor, it'll help us get through this. This is a very serious matter, but remain positive and safe. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Tinball. Now we'll go back down to the southeast area where I believe Nathan has a representative of the Dakota Dunes community.
Yes, thanks, Terry. Next, we'll hear from Jeff Dooley, Dakota Dunes Community Improvement District.
Good morning. Jeff Dooley, Dakota Dunes Community Improvement District. For Dakota Dunes residents, I just wanted to tell them that we are still planning for the same elevation of 1098 for our levees, and that has not changed. Today's elevation of the river is about 1090, just so you have that information for you. In regards to infrastructure, we're continuing with the plan I outlined at yesterday's conference. We'll be shutting down our water plant this afternoon and getting our water from the city of Sioux City through a long-term contract. We will also be implementing all necessary water restrictions that it would be appropriate for this situation. In regards to sanitary sewer, we plan on starting to plug off the sanitary sewer and some of the evacuated areas today to secure that. And we're continuing to work on the storm sewers to plug pipes that weren't known about before through diving teams and other methods. So we hope to have that secured sometime today, early tomorrow. I just wanted to thank the residents, and through our early communications with our residents, I think the residents grasped the severity of this situation and took appropriate steps. This was a huge part of giving us a chance to be able to complete this levee, and I want to thank them for their understanding and cooperation throughout this effort. You know, in an event like this, of this magnitude, everything can't go according to plan. We've had to adapt plans, they've had to adapt plans, their plans, and doing that has helped us get to the level we are on the levees, and it's greatly appreciated. And we hope that type of community cooperation can continue. On our way up here to Dakota Valley Schools today, we saw it in North Sioux City. And it is truly a comprehensive effort that everybody is taking part in. So good job, and let's keep it up. At my last briefing, I talked a little bit about security and how we will manage that going forward. And Dan Limoges is here to give you a little bit of specifics about that. So I'll just turn it over to him.
Thank you, Dan Limoges, Union County Sheriff. And, you know, this flood has really put a lot of demands on all of us, but I want to thank the governor, Lieutenant Governor, for what they've done and what they're going to continue to do. But I want to thank the residents of Union County, because they've made my job, our job, a lot easier because of their cooperation for the demands that we have put on them. And so thank you for that. We at law enforcement are running 24 hours a day throughout this region down here, all along the river, and we are committed to do that until it, whatever it takes. The evacuated areas that are in play are manned 24 hours. There are checkpoints, and we're going to stay with that as well. But I want the residents to know that we're here to protect you and your property. and that is for sure. But a message that I'd like to send out is to the criminal element that is out there. If you think that Union County is a opportunity for you, rest assured, think again, because you will be arrested. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheriff. Now I think we'll turn it back to Christy Terman at the Emergency Operations Center in Pierre.
Good morning, everybody. Again, I'm Christy Terman with the State Office of Emergency Management, running the EOC here in Pierre. We've had great reports from local officials, and that's where the best information is going to come from. So I don't want to belabor all of that information or repeat it. I just want to say that at the state level, we are really focusing on the 30,000-foot view and supporting current operations, but also looking ahead to the future and some of the issues and challenges and solutions that these communities are going to be facing, and what we can do at the state level to help facilitate response and recovery. Operations at the state level are really in two different stages. Here in the Pierre, Fort Pierre area, local officials are finalizing levee surveillance plans and emergency response plans. Their focus is really on watching the river rise. That's what we're waiting for here in the Pierre, Fort Pierre area. Watching that water come up and looking at the impact that it's having on the levee system. In Dakota Dunes, the focus down there is still on preparation. So at the state level, it's two different tempos, two different operations, but we are providing support to both of those. There's a lot of resources that have been committed to this incident. The largest support component on the state level has been the National Guard. Nearly 1,200 National Guard personnel from both the Army Guard and the Air Guard have been committed to assist with this incident. And they are assisting in levee security and emergency levee repair, sandbagging operations, traffic control, and evacuation, as well as air operations. So that's probably our largest component of this response on the state level as far as resources. In addition to that, the state has assisted in procuring sandbags for sandbagging operations locally. We have brought in additional law enforcement to help the affected areas. And we're also gathering up different equipment, such as water pumps, boats for search and rescue, generators in case power goes out to certain areas, light sets so that work can continue at night, waders in case National Guard personnel or other rescue personnel need to work in water. We've also staged water rescue teams down in the southeast part of the state, and we have one on standby for here in Pierre. So that's the type of support that at the state level is being coordinated by the state EOC. And we'll continue to do that as we move through the different phases of this operation. That's my report for today.
Thanks, Christy. We'll have questions now. And with the Lieutenant Governor down in the southeast area, we'll start down there. Take some questions there. You'll get a chance up here in the EOC, and then we'll open it up to anyone else. Nathan, are you ready with questions?
Yes, we're ready for questions here in Pierre. Here in Dakota Valley, my apologies. So are there any questions for media members in the audience?
The question is, how many people are still in the country club area of Dakota Dunes? There's a system in place that the law enforcement, under the direction of the sheriff, went through yesterday in quick order and actually found that there are 36 homes that either couldn't be identified where these individuals were, and within that 36, there were 11 homes where people were still occupied. So there's 36 total that we couldn't have an answer from, 11 people that had stayed, and they have or are in the process of being revisited today. So tremendous compliance. Sheriff, how many homes in there, Jeff, in total? About 600, and put it in perspective, I think there's about 630 homes in this region. So as you could see, that's why everything that the local officials and everyone have done, it's pretty impressive. Yes, sir. The question is, given the water situation with the releases and how fast that came upon them, there's obviously the way, you know, the wave of emotions that we've all gone through. Why could this be? What's the Corps doing? And there are certain political officials, elected officials, calling for investigations and whether or not the governor was going to launch or request an investigation of what's transpired. And the answer is no. We've had no conversation about that at all. We're dealing with the facts that are put with us right now through the teams and the issues and not looking at that. I will tell you so that the people understand, when you see individuals for the Corps of Engineers that you've heard over the phone or you see here locally, there are a tremendous number of individuals on the ground helping us. They are impressive people, and they are providing us highly technical training and information that we're trying to get in a usable format, and they're also going through a very, very tough time individually. And I know that doesn't sound as though that's satisfying to our anger and frustrations and questions, but we're dealing with the facts and the situations as we are now, and they've been very helpful. I just, before we came here, met for about 10 minutes with Colonel Rook. The colonel's in charge of this region, and he was talking about other aspects of what they're doing prospectively, and obviously he, like all of us, hasn't slept very much, and I think that that's impressive, and I appreciate the question. Any other questions? The question for everyone listening is how much money has been expended in the Southeast region to date and then statewide. We were reported this morning the expenditure here in the Southeast region is about $3.5 million at this stage of the game. Christy, do you have any numbers statewide?
Lieutenant Governor, I don't have those numbers. We're working to compile them. One of the key figures we were hoping to get was from the southeast corner of the state. So we'll finalize those figures and have a number for you later.
Christy, do you know the number for the Pier 4 area?
I do not at this time.
Any other
questions from here in Dakota Valley Union? Yes, sir. Sure, just a second, Mayor. Come on up. Are there any other questions? Yes, ma'am. That's a good idea. There's a question from citizens about the road that's coming in here, and I did see it choked up coming through, and we've noted that and are going to make a request and deal with the mayor and any ideas you have to reroute it, because it's coming in here at where we're at in the Dakota Valley School. It's creating a choke point. If you're not familiar with this area, it goes around McCook Lake, and there really isn't a whole lot of latitude on either side. There's a huge sandbagging operation, and we do need to address that. Thank you for reiterating. And follow up? Yes, ma'am. The question is the secondary levee here in the Dakota Dunes Country Club area is how it's generally described. One, where is it, the secondary levee going to be placed? And is it in the middle of the road, the side of the road? How is that placement take place? If you know the roads, it actually goes and starts at Monterey. and will tie into the primary levee there to make a circle, essentially. And at Monterey Circle there, it'll cut through into the external area there out towards the river. So it pull all the way through Pinehurst West and East Pinehurst and then tie out straight to the bike path on the Big Sioux. So if you're looking at that, the second part of that question is, where will it be placed? And it will cover the entire road. It will have to be large enough and tall enough to get to the 1100 elevation. So it will cover that entire road through its base. The houses that face south will be in the front or the back. I've been there a few times. The best way to answer that is it goes down the street, Pinehurst. So if you live in Pinehurst, it would be inaccessible if you were living there regardless, because it's a big dirt wall with the base. Is that helpful? And we can... Correct. And we can talk afterwards, because obviously you're familiar with that area. It's probably your home, but it's obstructed entirely. And there's obviously that's why we need the evacuation. So thank you, ma'am. Another question. Thank you. The question is, it sounded like the secondary levee will be completed Tuesday, and I think it's a Tuesday-Wednesday time frame, depending on obviously everything else, but that's pretty realistic. Will essentially the people who refuse to leave be trapped, if you will? We want to understand that. We do believe that we will get to the point where the 11 people or individuals in their homes will be convinced that it's time to come out. There will be certain aspects of that that will make it difficult, because there won't be any sewer. They're plugging everything up. It's just, as you can well imagine, hard on them. And I can imagine that just talking with them, the sheriff and other people will know them, that we won't need to do anything forceful. There's enough trauma here, and I'm pretty optimistic. And the reason that I'm optimistic is, like here, where we're at in McCook Lake and Dakota Valley, families, friends take care of friends and families. And if they're entrenched, we'll hopefully find other people that can convince them that the net's closing. It's time to get out. Other questions? Yes, sir. Yes, the question was, this gentleman's mother, a grandmother, lives on Lake Francis Case in the central part of our state. And the question is directed at you, Eric, and that is, has the Corps looked at, and she's safe, as the question posed, and has the Corps looked at taking more water into Lake Francis Case to slow down the water coming down here?
That is exactly the case that is happening right now. Lake Francis Case is going to be absorbing some of this water out of Oahe and giving some time to the people downstream. So that is exactly what's happening.
Okay, thank you. Are there questions in Pier, please?
Lieutenant Governor Tony Mangan at KCCR Radio. Could you talk a little bit about what you've seen from the people? Both you and the governor have talked about the people in both Pier and Fort Pier and Dakota Dunes. What has struck you most about the people that you, when you've been walking the streets and talking to people, what has struck you the most about them?
You know, a lot of the same traits that you and all of us have. One is ingenuity. two is don't wait for a government or individuals to come in. Let's build our levee on our own. Have you ever thought about doing this? I'm not very technical. I don't know how to change oil or things like that. You could probably teach me. The governor obviously has those gifts, and he's looking and he's always saying, why don't we do this? My thought process is more of how come it's not structured this way from a procedure. You had a gentleman yesterday who had a farming background, and he came up with an incredible idea. Just that's what strikes me initially. The second is the way that we all react as a community. My wife and I were in the Navy and lived different places, and we lived in a big city, and you don't have, at one point in time in Florida, she came back home, Tony, one day as a nurse, and she was sort of choked up, and she said, do you realize that no one's really from here? And what she meant was there wasn't an emotional tie so that when you went and you saw your patient, that you could say that this is Dan Limoges' brother, and I knew him, I went to college with him, and all of the people that pour in to help. It really has been an ongoing and overwhelming aspect. Number two is certainly people who work for the state and the federal governments are paid by us as taxpayers. But like all of everybody who is working to help, they're going above and beyond. They're doing their own jobs, working 24/7, 365, and then they're going and sandbagging. And we've seen that in Pier. You've seen that with friends all the way down the entire river, that's strong and that they're resilient. And finally, I do think, as the governor has said, and we're continuing to emphasize, people are understanding that there are a lot of things in this world you don't control. And those things that you do control is holding your loved ones close, because the time is fleeting. Any other questions?
I'd like to direct the same question to Mayor Gill. How has the community of Pier really came together? I've heard a lot of positive things being here.
Right, you're right. What we have done, what we saw when we put the word out, asking the citizens to prepare their property as if there was going to be no government help, everybody rallied. You would drive down the streets of town and there were people congregating all over, getting together, doing sandbagging work together. Some neighborhoods did their own projects, their own diking projects and levee projects, without thought of individual yard lines and that kind of thing. So we're so proud of the people that live here and how they have taken care of themselves and each other.
More questions here?
Eric, talk a little bit about the 10.5 inches. Are you thinking about 10.5 inches per day?
Well, that 10.5 inches was for that 15,000 cubic feet per second. As you go up in the floodplain, that water has a wider area to go into. So it's going to spread out more. So as we continue up with this, it's going to get somewhat less of a rise for the same amount of flow increase. And we've really haven't done the same flow increase so you can get a good feel for it, except for when we were coming up to the 85. So we've got some estimates and we're watching it real closely. The other thing that we're doing is we're working with the United States Geological Survey, and they're going out on the river as we do these increases. They're taking measurements of the river so that in the future, if this happens again, we will have a good rating curve for these gauges so that we'll know better in the future what's going to happen at higher flows.
What should the residents be watching for? As now that you got through one day, what should the residents be watching for as the more water comes out? Are they going to see a substantial increase in the water, you think? Or are they going to see water that they haven't seen in places before? What should they, as they're watching their properties, what should they be watching for?
Well, and you pretty much answered the question. I mean, you need to be watching for where that water's going to go. It's I put the 10.5 inches out just so people understood kind of how much it was going to rise with that 15,000 cubic feet to get a feel for things. And to realize that 10.5 inches happened over a 12 to 14 hour period before it started slowing down and kind of settling out. So it was a gradual rise, and it was something that you just need to keep your eye on and make sure you're aware of it.
What is the river level at present?
I can tell you at six o'clock today, the pier gauge was at elevation 1430.6.
Are you seeing any efficiencies in the river like they did up in Bismarck and on the Soros in North Dakota? In other words, scouring and so on. Can you address that, please?
You know, we think we might be seeing some of that at this point in time. But again, to really see that, you have to have steady state flows for a while just so you can kind of track the elevations and get an idea of what's going on.
Nothing that would make you change your forecast?
You know, right now, no. Our forecasts are set out there, and they're good forecasts.
Eric, two questions for you. The first question is, if today all levees in Pier and Fort Pier should be at 1436 with plastic, is that...
Well, the plastic is still going on, but they're topped out with earth.
They all will be at 1436, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And then the other question I have for you is, the last couple of days we've been splitting up the flows, half in the morning, half in the afternoon, but from now on that we're only increasing up to 10,000 that will be in the morning. You said the reason why we decided to split the two, or the reason you decided to split the two, was to give people more time to prepare. Is this going to be a huge impact on people in the morning when they see it's at 10,000 higher than it was the day before?
Well, with today, we're actually showing those two 10,000 CFS inflows, I mean increases over the day, so for a total of 20,000. So it was done just so people could kind of get a good feeling for what's going on. After we do the two increases today, I'm just got to imagine that Omaha was saying, okay, we've seen the increases, we've seen what's going on, and people will have a handle on how this is going to come up. And that's why they didn't split the other days. Plus, you know, we're going there today.
Could that change later today if they say, oh, this was a huge impact, or is it that's just the set way it's going to be at 8 a.m.?
At this point in time, this is the schedule. Anything can change at any time.
Is the river behaving like you would expect it would with these increases? Is there anything out of the ordinary that's happened?
I believe everything is, nothing out of the ordinary that I've heard of.
Eric, could you take a look at the river and the dikes? You have said you believe the levees are going to hold. But at what point in this five-day process, like whether it's at 120, 130, do you say in your mind, we have reached, you know, we know for sure that the levees are holding? I mean, in your mind, when do you reach, do you really believe that the levees are going to hold? Or is there a point in time where the levees pass the muster test, I guess?
Basically, and again, we consider a levee on the first filling of a levee just like the first filling of a dam. We check the integrity quite frequently. So we're going to be watching these structures very, very closely for at least the first 72 hours and beyond that. I mean, there's going to be continued surveillance, but we're going to be especially diligent in our inspections for those first 72 hours.
When do you hope to have the plastic on the Fort Pierce side of the levee? I actually took the boat ride with the USGS this morning. There's a little bit of water right at the base. They're kind of turning muddy at the bottom. How soon is that plastic going to go?
As soon as the contractor can get it on. He's working diligently. He's split his crew. They've got their method down, and their production is up. So we think he's going to get done today, hopefully.
I have a question for Mayor Gill. You said tomorrow morning you guys are going to be starting the credential process. So that means if I have a home and I'm moved out of that home, but I want to be able to go check on my sub pumps and things like that, I have to go to Georgia Moore Middle School tomorrow at 8 a.m. and say, this is my property. I want to be able to get in and out of there.
Yeah, the process will start at 8 a.m. and we will be rolling out information through the media throughout today as to how that will really work. But essentially, folks will be able to get a card that they can use to identify themselves to get into their neighborhoods. And that helps control who should be there. And those that are asking to get in that aren't credentialed, they'll need some approval process from the homeowner. So it's a system to allow security so that people are confident as they're evacuating that there's some security measures in place.
And this will be the system for both communities, both Peoria and Fort Pierce?
I believe so, yes, being set up for both communities.
Mayor, I understand there's been police coming in from other cities in South Dakota. Do you have the resources you need to do the security job on the levees and elsewhere?
Yes, we do. It's been a great operation because we have had the Pierre Police Department supplanted. We have Highway Patrol joining us, Game Fish and Parks, National Guard, and so we've had really a combined unit, and it's been very helpful. We've also had police officers and law enforcement from outside municipalities and counties that have been sworn in. So South Dakota is really stepping up to help us out here to keep our security in place.
Take one more question here, and then we'll see if anyone on the phones wants to ask anything. Any questions here?
So how many houses have been affected, I guess, overall, and then also since it's been stepped up from 85,000 to, like, 100 and change at this point? What's been the increase?
Do we have
well,
not even values, but just your numbers?
I'll speak for the Pierre area. What we did was we looked at the area that was projected to have flooding, and we used census data and found the residential areas there. And in Pierre, it's approximately a little over 800 structures that house people, and that includes houses, mobile homes, and apartments.
Okay, and that's overall up till this point?
Yeah, that's in the area that was projected, that 1434 water level that we're using right now as our projected flooding area, and that's for Pierre. Uh-huh. And Fort Pierre has additional effect. Mayor Tingle.
Yes. The number of houses, of course, is less, but still about 500 and some structures that will be affected, could be affected. Now, as far as currently being affected, we don't have very many structures that are really being inundated or water in them at this point, but we may have some more later on. But right now, we're quite optimistic about the levee system and our pumping operation to try to keep everybody as dry as we possibly can. But there are a few houses that we can't protect.
So it's just a handful right now.
That's right.
Yes, and I should clarify as well, my numbers were projected what potentially uh-huh. could be affected. It's very little effect at this time.
Okay. No properties of value, I mean, of importance, no structures other than houses that we should be aware of?
Right now, we're just watching the water rising. It's largely in the pier side. We have a lot of park system that's being inundated now as we speak. There are some homes that are getting groundwater in the basement, and the water is starting to get into some backyards in Southeast Pier. So it's moving, and at this moment, it's probably starting to move into some neighborhoods, but it's really a watch as we go today.
Thank you. We'll go to the phones and see if anyone listening wants to ask a question or two.
Harry, this is Nathan down in Dakota Dunes. We've got a quick comment from the mayor of North Sioux City.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm Don Fuchs, the mayor of North Sioux City. The North Sioux City area consists of McCook Lake and North Sioux City. The first comment I would like to make is our lieutenant governor and governor has shown outstanding leadership and cooperation through this entire crisis that we are dealing with. The second comment I would like to make regards the levees at McCook Lake, which there has been some discussion on. Those levees have been completed. We are in the process of raising those levees to some additional height to allow for some freeboard with the water movement. So but that's the comment that I wanted to make, that the levees at McCook Lake have been completed and we're in the process of raising them. Thank you,
Mr. Mayor. Now we can go to any questions from media members on the phone.
Questions from anyone on the phone? If not, I'll turn to Lieutenant Governor Michaels for a brief wrap-up comment.
Well, again, I want to thank the media partners for getting information out there because it's so critical. In addition to that, I know that we're going to keep our spirits up, and I'll reiterate, these are things that matter to us, but they're not lives. We have not lost a life. We've had a couple of injuries, and please, oh please, respect the water, respect what's transpiring. No one has ever seen this. And so we can, as we normally do, we want to see, can you tell me what the weather is going to be tomorrow? We want to know specifically because I want to plan a picnic. And sometimes a storm comes up. Sometime another event is. So we will continue to be surprised by changing events, but be careful, be watchful, listen to the authorities, those that have put this together, and please take care of each other. Now, we're going to have questions. Everyone will have questions as this continues through our flood fight. So go to our website, BeReadySD.com, BeReadySD.com, and you'll get information flow there. If you want to call, call our Emergency Operations Center helpline, 1-866-446-5324, 866-446-5324. And thank you very, very much. The people of South Dakota, we're going to get through this. We are resilient. Take care of each other. Thank you.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. That will wrap up our media call today. Thank you very much.